Hello and welcome to worship. So glad you are here. Whether you're worshiping with us in person or online, worship would not be the same without you. Worship is that time when we offer a prayer to God that the joys we bring to worship are heightened and the burdens we bring to worship are lightened. So I'm just going to take a moment as we move into this time to be aware of whatever you are carrying into worship, a concern, a joy, a gratitude. It amplifies the power of worship when we know what we bring to it. So just a moment for you to kind of see what's percolating, what you carry in your head and heart this morning. And we offer that to God. And my prayer is God meets you in that place and empowers us to go into the world as God's love, God's justice, God's mercy. We're now going to wrap up a sermon series that we've been calling The Stories That Shape Us. I learned something about telling stories, that when we share a story or when we hear a story, it releases this natural hormone in our system called oxytocin, which increases social bonding. It's also a crucial, there are pharmaceutical versions, we're sticking with the natural version of oxytocin. It's also a crucial ingredient in all the events that lead up to childbirth. One other fun fact about oxytocin, the older you get, the more oxytocin you have in your system. So if you're getting older, this is a good thing in terms of the kindness and connection and awareness we bring to the world. Anyways, stories are good medicine. They help us connect to one another, and stories of faith help us connect to God, that presence that is always with us. And that's where our opening hymn leads us, reminding us we love to tell stories. Let us sing, stand, tap our feet together. So today we're talking about the good social bonding and connection we feel when we tell stories, that release of oxytocin, the same one that's needed for childbirth. So it's a no-brainer about which scripture to pick to go with this. It's a story of the birth of Jesus as told in the Gospel of Luke. We hear it perhaps as a familiar story, but the original hearers might have noticed something sketchy about this story, but let's give it a listen first as our liturgist, Dick Lamb, reads to us.
Hear now the scripture from the book of Luke. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration that was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged, and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the guest room. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Join me in a moment of prayer. Oh God, as we explore the stories of our faith, may the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts, and the living of this day be pleasing in your sight, our God, our Creator, our strength, and our Redeemer. Amen. So that story of Jesus' birth might evoke comforting, cozy memories for most of the listeners if it's familiar to you. Is it a familiar story? If you're watching with us online, you got to raise your hand really loud so that it's a familiar story to many. And it reminds us often of Christmas Eve and candlelight services. But I can tell you for sure, the original hearers of this story, the original context for this story, weren't thinking about gathering in a sanctuary with candlelight for Christmas Eve. And it's possible that they noticed some discrepancies in this story. The list of political leaders, according to the Gospel of Luke, don't match with Roman historical records. That story of the registration or the census, that didn't happen that year. And the Gospel of Matthew says Herod was the governor during that time. And here we have Quirinius. What do we do when we encounter Bible passages that are inconsistent or contradictory, don't match up with other sources of information? It's an important question to ask. Truth is, a lot of Bible commentators, researchers, theologians bend over backwards to try to make it fit, to try to ignore the contradictions. And in fact, I know there are folks in every congregation I serve that are deeply distressed when there is contradictions or inconsistencies. It's almost like they prompts them to dismiss the whole Bible because of that. I want to offer these ways of looking, because really the question is, how do we read the Bible with this? The Bible is full of contradictions and inconsistencies. It doesn't always match up with other sources of historical documents. Why not just accept that? There are 66 books in the Bible written for all different communities at different times from different perspectives. It's not going to be consistent. So maybe the question worth exploring is, if that really rattles and disturbs you, why is that? Why is our expectation of Scripture that it will always be consistent without contradictions? Why is that important to some? It might not be important to you. Here are two ways that you might want to experiment with in reading the Bible. First of all, read the Bible. There are no negative side effects to reading the Bible at home during the week. I do it. I have a devotional that has a short passage, and I read it every morning. But before I read it, it's a bit like stretching before you play pickleball or golf or tennis or run or swim or whatever it is your thing. You know, you kind of do a little warm-up. It's good to do a warm-up before reading Scripture. It's good to pause. It's good to notice what you're carrying in your head and your heart. One of the questions I ask myself before I read Scripture in the morning is, what most needs my attention today? And here's the thing. Then when I read Scripture, 85% or more of the time, what I read offers me insight for the hours and day ahead. I don't think it's magic. I think it's how the Bible allows us to be in conversation with God. There are so many ways to read the Bible. We do not look at the Bible as infallible or inerrant. We look at the Bible as a conversation, an ongoing conversation with God's presence right here with us. I'm always curious about how other people read the Bible. Take me out for coffee sometime and tell me how you read or don't read the Bible. But I happened to be on vacation staying in someone's house, and I pulled a book off the bookshelf. I love to eavesdrop on people's bookshelves, by the way. It's just, I think you should know that about me. And this one was written by a theologian and an author called Andrew Scheer. He grew up thinking he would become a priest in the Catholic tradition, and his family did too. And yet he shifted gears somewhere in that, and he earned his PhD in clinical psychology. But what fascinated him about working with clients was the same thing that fascinated him in his own faith journey. What allows us to grow and transform? What are the needed ingredients for humans to grow in their capacity to be God's love alive in the world? What is needed to be transformed again and again into the image and likeness of God? And through his practice and through studying all types of religions, he noticed that we need four ingredients. We need to know how to respond in times of change. We need to know how to go through times of suffering. We need to know how to receive joy. We need to know how to mature in service to others, in being aware of the needs around us. And then he reread the Bible, and I think we have a slide for this one. He read the Bible, and he noticed each gospel account of Jesus' life asks one of those questions. Matthew focuses on how do we face change. That was after the temple was destroyed. Mark focuses on how do we move through suffering. That was a time when Christians were being persecuted and killed. And John asks, how do we receive joy? And Luke, the gospel we're looking at today, is how do we mature in service? That's one way. This isn't a formula for reading the Gospels or a lens for reading the Gospel, but if Luke is focused on how do we mature in service, that gives us a whole new lens for reading it through, and you'll notice something right away. You'll notice that Luke, the Gospel of Luke, focuses on economic and social justice. By justice, I mean making sure that we're not just stuck in a status quo of how we treat resources and money and each other, that making it a world where all have what they need, making it a world where all are loved and included. I'm just going to focus on that economic justice that is emphasized in Luke, and then look back at our scripture for today. When, you know, if you're looking for a good story, a story that shapes you, a story that has lots of oxytocin in it, read the Gospel of Luke. Because there are more parables or stories per square inch in the Gospel of Luke than in any other book in the Bible. And some of them only appear in Luke. I'm just going to read you some samples, and you tell me what theme emerges. Okay, tag your it after I read it. Two debtors, the inopportune friend asking for money, the rich fool, the lost piece of silver, the unrighteous manager who took advantage of others, the rich man and Lazarus, the Pharisee and the tax collector. Money, yeah, money. Over and over again, the stories in Luke kind of jolt us into a new way of living with our resources, of making sure not only do we have enough, but everyone has enough. That is God's dream for how we live together in community. And it's an ongoing challenge for us. It's a good bracing reminder that we are here not just to take care of ourselves, but each other. That is the way of Jesus. And it's something you've been doing as a community, and I keep forgetting to update you on how you're doing it, because I want you to know how in the past several years, you, as part of the United Methodist Church, have made a difference, a profound difference, in response to wildfires in Northern California, not only by your financial donations, which have been incredibly generous to the disaster response ministry of our conference, but also, I remember we've gathered in the courtyard and put together fire buckets and sent those to the depots that now deliver them. But this is where some of your money and work go in terms of taking care of others. Like the fire that is in the Mariposa County area. Steve Elliott from this congregation and other people leave today to set up a local assistance center That's where we band with other nonprofits, faith groups, government agencies, and it's a one-stop shop so people can get their DMV stuff again, get assistance. At the United Methodist table, you make possible, we hand them a gift card for immediate needs like diapers and other things that they might not, that have been destroyed in a fire. We also provide a fire bucket that you help make happen. In that is all the ingredients to safely go back to a burned down area, hazmat suits and shields and shovels and rakes and cleaning supplies. But that's not all. The Methodist table offers spiritual care as well. And this is how we define spiritual care. It's a place where people are heard and listened and seen. The volunteers that serve in that capacity ask people how they're doing, and they're not just about a transaction. They're about listening to the story, because everyone that lands there has a harrowing story to tell. And we take the time we need. We're not in a hurry. We let people cry. We let people rage. We let people be silent. And that's the spiritual care we offer as well. And you have made that possible through donations, through showing up. And if you hear a nudge, a call to be part of that early response team that goes and sits at those tables and offers that type of care, get on the conference website, the Cal Nevada United Methodist Church, or call our church office and we'll tell you more about what's involved. I've heard one person say, I live with him, so I know his stories well. I heard my husband Steve say it is the most meaningful expression of his faith that he has ever encountered. Something to think about as we learn to mature in our faith and in our service. But that's not all you do. I have one more installment of what you have made possible after fires. After the initial response, we sometimes go back with people to people's homes so they don't go alone to look for pet bones or valuables. We walk alongside them in our own hazmat suits and do that with them. But just because a fire is over doesn't mean all the needs are met. The Methodist Church that you make possible also works for long-term needs. And that's the last piece I want to tell you about what you have made possible as a way of maturing in service to the people around us. Take the 2020 unmet needs of the Bear Fire, which was part of a great big complex fire. After everyone has left, after some FEMA money, maybe, some PG&E money, maybe, there are still people that have played by all the rules but don't have their needs met. And so the Methodist Church, along with a group of others, have a long-term, an unmet needs committee that meets monthly, has caseworkers that present cases. Here are some that we funded because of your help as a Methodist Church recently. There was a couple in their 60s who are raising their granddaughter with autism in the Bear Fire area. They lost their manufactured home in a fire. They moved to an old RV next to their daughter's home, got carbon monoxide poisoning due to poor venting in the RV, but are still living in it. So we, along with other groups, provided money to fund a mobile home, which would be safe and ventilated and provide what they need. An older man with physical and cognitive disabilities lost his home, his mobile home, in the fire. He's uninsured. He's living in a gutted out travel trailer with no toilet. He's awaiting decision on eligibility for SSI, that's supplemental security income. And we funded, with your help, septic, access to a well and well power, and a trailer. A senior, age 73, with cancer and failing health, lives on a very modest Social Security pre-fire. And pre-fire was living in a room he rented for $100 a month, and it burned down. The van he purchased with FEMA money was stolen, and he lost his extensive CD collection in the fire. And that's important because those CDs ended a local radio music show that was his hobby. We funded a month of temporary motel stay while awaiting completion of an apartment. This is what it means to live into the call from the Gospel of Luke, to care for each other. And now let's reflect, if that's one of the themes in the Gospel of Luke, then let's go back to the story we read. Maybe the author of the Gospel of Luke wasn't being sloppy with historical facts. That's not consistent with the details in his writing style. Maybe he purposely, for narrative impact, put Quirinius, who might not have been governor during that time, in that story, because when people hear the word Quirinius in first century Palestine, they're thinking not only was he known for his fierce military conquests, he was also known for being excessively wealthy. Maybe the author of Luke was making a point that Jesus' birth, Jesus' life, offers us a contrast in how to live, in how to serve, and how to mature in our service to others. And thank you, San Ramon United Methodist Church, for being a place where we grow and mature in faith, where we consistently are willing to look at the needs around us so that it's not just that our needs are met, but together, all needs are met. And that is something that is God's dream for this world and God's dream for us. And our next piece of music invites us to say thank you, God, for creating us that way to be your people alive in this world. Let us continue worship with music.
Filled with joyful praise. We've had so much to be thankful for this week, and I know that this week with Vacation Bible School has been medicine for the soul. It's been a joy hearing the voices of children. And so this is a celebration this week of how our financial offerings have helped make Vacation Bible School possible. And so we have a few slides to show you here, and we'll say a little bit more about this in a few minutes. It was a lot of fun this week. And so as we give this week, we have several different ways. We have a QR code for online that you can hover your phone over on the camera mode. There's also our website, srvumc.org/give. And as you leave the sanctuary, we have an offering plate in the back. And so as we give today, let us give generously. Let us give joyfully. And let us give with a heart full of gratitude.
Let us be in a moment of prayer. Almighty and gracious God, as we come to give you our tithes and offerings, we are grateful for the many blessings you have bestowed upon us that make these gifts possible. Continue to fill our hearts with your Holy Spirit so that we can truly love one another as you have loved us. In Jesus' name, amen.
As we come to this time of prayer, once again, we want to thank everybody who helped out with Vacation Bible School and for all of those who showed up in many different ways. And a big thank you to Laura and Tom Roy for putting it together. And so let's give everyone a hand who helped out today. We also want to lift up continued prayers for Bruce Bensler as underlying complicated medical issues are making his recovery from a fall challenging. The family requests our prayers and cards, but no visits at this time, please. We continue to lift up all of those who have been affected by COVID-19 and who are ill with COVID-19. We also lift up prayers for the McKinney Fire in the Klamath National Forest. Prayers for those affected by the Oak Fire in the Mariposa area who lost homes, and for all of the firefighters and the first responders. And so as we lift all of these prayers that have been spoken, all of the prayers that are on our hearts, let us go to God in prayer. Our most loving and holy God, we give you thanks for the week that has been. Give you thanks for the joy of children's voices and children running around, and thank you for our vacation Bible school. And yet at the same time, we lift up prayers that are on our hearts, prayers that are sometimes heavy and sometimes too much for words. Yet you know what is on our hearts, O Lord. And so we lift up prayers of healing and wholeness, prayers of comfort, prayers of encouragement and strength, prayers for our world, for our church, prayers for those who have been affected by fire and natural disaster, and even the prayers that are unspoken. And so, Lord, today and this week, we lift these prayers to you. We place them into your hands, and we leave them at your throne of grace. And so, with the disciples from generation to generation, let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This week and beyond, we have opportunities to serve, and a couple opportunities I want to highlight is that on August 16th at 12 noon, we have our Lunch with Friends, and it's also a barbecue that day, too. So RSVP to the office, and it's tri-tip, which will be delicious, and so mark your calendar and plan to attend a wonderful time together. We also have Acolyte training coming up on August 28th, which will be after church, so any kids that are grades 2 and up are welcome to come, and they will light the candles before worship and then head off to Sunday school during that time. Yeah, so this is a wonderful thing. Oh,
one more.
Oh, and Pastor Kim has one more.
You'll see on the screen that my email's been spoofed. again. There's an email that looks like it comes from me, and the latest one goes something like this. Hi, what time will you be free today? I will appreciate your swift response. Thanks. Thank you for all your swift responses. However, if you look carefully at that email, it doesn't come from me. See how weird the email address is? churchoffice549@gmail.com. I'm so sorry this is happening. Please be sure and check. Don't respond to those emails. If I need your swift response, I will call you. And we'll communicate that way. And again, I'm sorry that that's happening. Please be alert. Please be slightly suspicious as you look closely at emails. And now we get to sing one of the best hymns ever. Here I am, Lord. So with hearts willing to serve and mature in service, let us sit or stand and sing our final hymn. Are called to be the people that say, here I am, Lord, send me. And come back next week for worship, because next week we're going on safari. That's all I'm saying, but you'll want to be part of that entourage. And now hear the words of William Sloan Coffin as we go out to be God's presence alive in God's world. May God bless you and keep you and be gracious unto you. May God grant you the grace to never sell yourself or God short. May God grant you the grace to risk something big for something good. Grace to know the world is too dangerous for anything but truth and too small for anything but love. So may God take your mind and think through it. May God take your lips and speak through them. And may God take your heart and set it on fire. Go forward together to be the presence of God together in this world. Amen.